Here's a sentence I never thought I'd utter. Today, Australia's esteemed senators channeled their inner Little John to... Philip Lowe, that is.
Very, very low.
The Reserve Bank Governor feeling the heat... as he faced a good old-fashioned grilling.
You've put up interest rates 9 times in a row, overdoing monetary stimulus. You seem prepared to smash Australia into a recession. Can you explain why you still deserve to hold your job?
Lowe insisted he won't be standing down as he shared the blame around.
The fact that it's all sheeted down to me is it's a bit unfair. There are 9 people, it's not just me, a board of 9 people. The 9 people who sit on the board of the Reserve Bank, it's not just me. We have 9 people. There are 9 of us, including Michelle.
The real bad guy, he says, is inflation.
Raising interest rates is always unpopular, but we keep doing our job. And our job is to make sure inflation comes down. It's easier for me to do unpopular things than it is for maybe some of you. I don't know.
Duh.
Speaking of unpopular decisions...
What did you share with a bunch of bankers that you can't share with mortgage holders and renters? And why did the bond market jump so markedly actually during that lunch that you had?
The governor forced to defend himself over his decision to lunch with a bunch of bankers rather than front up for his usual post-rate rise speech to the public last week.
There's nothing untoward here. I can't live in a bubble. I need to talk to people.
It's the timing of it.
It's the timing, and I accept the timing kind of... people find that kind of difficult, and if I'd had my time again, I'd do things differently, but we have changed our policy now.
Bougie bank lunches now off the menu. Rate rises, not so much.
I don't think we're at the peak yet.
With more pain to come for Aussies and for Philip Lowe, who's set to face another grilling on Friday. Well,
Guardian political reporter Amy Remakis is here with the lowdown. See what we did there. Hey, Amy, what did you make of Philip Lowe's performance under pressure?
First of all, it's amazing that we're talking about the RBA governor in prime time. It sort of shows the economic conditions that we're in at the moment. And I think that he came out with a pretty main message, which was, it's not just me. I am not just the RBA. You can't blame me for absolutely everything. That seemed to be the main thing he wanted to get across. I think listening to it, he said something like, it's not just me, about 4 times. And he mentioned about another 5 times that there were actually 9 people on the RBA board. So some of that criticism is certainly hitting Governor Lowe at the moment.
It seemed to be quite an interesting vibe in the room today, Amy. Just how tense was it?
It wasn't actually tense, which, it's a little strange when you've got the guy who's raising everyone's interest rates and a bunch of senators going, why are you doing this? Phil Lowe is very, very, very well served at these committees. He knows exactly what he's doing, not his first time at the rodeo. But it was more just trying to drill down in why we are getting these interest rate rises. And he was saying that I'm doing this for the good of the Australian people, that it is, well, not me, the 9 people on the RBA board, that it is for the good of the economy because we don't want inflation to stay high for very, very long. And he mentioned how not many people remember what it was like in the 70s. I don't, wasn't alive, but that it was a very, very bad time in the 70s. And it really wrecked Australia's economy for some time. And that's what the RBA board is trying to avoid.
Amy, we heard Lowe defending the bougie bank lunch that he's been copping a bit of heat for. I love a long lunch, so I'm not going to criticise the man there. But is that the end of it? Will we hear any more of that?
Well, yeah, I don't think we're going to see Phil Lowe breaking bread with bankers anytime soon. I think that is one of the things that he really wanted to get across to people was he lunched with them for a reason because he can't live in a bubble and he needs to get input from the markets, but he won't do it again because he understands how it looks. One of the things that was interesting is that he was asked, why aren't you hearing from people who these interest rate rises are actually hitting? Why aren't you listening to mortgage holders or renters? And he said that he's trying to do that and his team is trying to do that, but it's a little bit more difficult. But I reckon we could probably get a group around a table just to, have some cheese bread and just explain what life is like at the moment.
If you can afford it with all the rate rises. Hey, Lowe also defended the big bank's record profits. How do you think that went down with Aussie homeowners?
Well, it wasn't exactly the most relatable moment defending the Commonwealth Bank for its $5.1 billion profit. Just in 6 months, it's made about $9 billion over the last year. And I think that's one of the issues. People are looking at it and just saying, well, you're basically just giving the banks free money with these interest rate rises, which is what is happening. You're taking money from mortgage holders, and only about a third of Australians hold a mortgage, so it's not exactly like it's evenly shared out. You're taking money from them, you're giving it to the banks for free, who are then giving it to their shareholders. So in the Commonwealth Bank's case, that's about $3.5 billion going to shareholders just in the last 6 months. And I think that is why people are really starting to say we probably need some different ideas here, because Phil Lowe is saying this is not the last interest rate rise, and I think people are pretty much feeling like they're at the brink already.
Absolutely. All right, Amy, thanks so much for your time tonight.
Thank you.
That last point Amy makes about we need some different ideas is actually, I think, the most interesting point. And that's not a Philip Lowe point, because it's not on Philip Lowe to come up with other ideas. He has one thing he can do to deal with inflation, and that is raise interest rates. And that's that.
So what are those other mechanisms then to start bringing inflation down?
Right, well, that would fall on government. Mm. He said, as in the government we elect, they could do all sorts of things. They could do with tax policy. If you want to take heat out of the economy, like, basically, to deal with inflation, you need to take money away from people. That's the unfortunate thing, and no one enjoys that, but that's what you've got to do. So you could do that through tax. You could, I don't know, increase the GST or something. Mm-hmm. That would take money away from people. You could do it with government spending. Right? The new government has a whole lot of things it wants to do that are going to be really expensive, things that people like, right? Like the childcare policy they've got or whatever. They've got a whole lot of things they want to do. All of that is going to make inflation worse.
But that's fiscal policy, right? Like, Philip Lowe himself even says or admits that monetary policy, the stuff that the RBA is in charge of, is still arguably the better or more effective, most effective tool in bringing down inflation.
That's the theory. But what we're seeing now is that may not be true. Because you can't basically set up a thing where we're going to ask monetary policy to solve all our problems, which means our only lever is to put interest rates up. Mm. And then when he does it, go, how dare you put interest rates up? Mm. That's a broader question for politics, isn't it? And it's not as much fun. Like, it's fun just bashing up Philip Lowe, right?
But the problem is it's the vulnerable people that have to cop it the hardest,
yes.
Right? That's the worst part, that we're taking from the people who don't already... they don't have enough money to begin with.
And, agreed, yeah. Which is why if it became a government policy issue, it's a different conversation.
Yeah.